So, good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. This is Julian Correa. I'm joined with my mother, Marilyn Correa. She's by profession a teacher. She was a teacher for more than 43 years, and now she is retired. By retirement, I mean that she's retired from teaching in a school, but she continues to offer her services to various institutions, schools, as an educationist and advice on all the things related to education, the development of a student, children, etc. So I welcome my mother. Say hello, mom.
Hello.
So how are you today?
Very fine.
Very fine. So I feel this podcast will be a good one for our listeners. For our listeners, would you just care to introduce yourself, a brief introduction, and maybe how you started this career of yours and over a period of 43 years, and how means just in brief.
I almost taught for 43 years active service. Now
Okay.
after yes, active service, after I retired, I still continue. So there's no question of retirement for me.
So you are
From active service, I have retired,
Okay,
but
so
I still
okay.
continue to give services to the institutions.
Okay. That's good to know because many senior citizens actually after retirement they become house birds and involve themselves in recreational activities and all. It's good to know that you are continuing with your something related to your past profession.
You know, Julian,
Yeah.
age is just a matter of number.
Yeah, that's
Okay,
very
I
true.
still feel I am young, energetic.
Okay. And this w now you were a teacher with Karnataka syllabus. That's it, the
State
state
syllabus.
syllabus. So now it's changed to CBSE, if I'm not mistaken. The schools in Karnataka.
Gradually, they are changing the
Okay.
syllabus to CBSE.
So what do you have to say about it? Do you like CBSE better than the state?
Anything, I don't say this is better than that.
Okay.
Anything, because the quantity of knowledge that you get is the same. It's only the methods and excessive topics are introduced, I think. It doesn't matter. The
So,
approach to teaching is important.
yeah. So when you started out teaching, how was the scenario? Like it was 43 years. It's a two generations, in fact.
Yeah, 4 decades.
4 decades, two generations of two
Yes.
or three, maybe even three, you can
Let
say.
me be precise, Julian. I have taught boys and I taught their children also, their sons.
Okay.
So 2 generations.
So, what was the scenario that time? How like now you use smart boards? Then you were it was just chalk and board. And
Nothing. I don't feel anything lesser because since I love my profession, I use the chalk and the board to its fullest.
yeah, you can write with both hands. That's
Ambidextrous,
that's what
yes.
everyone remembers you for.
Yes.
So, okay, let's start by you started as a primary teacher, if I'm
Yes.
not mistaken.
Yes.
So, how like what did you observe? Like how does a child start? Like a child learns from his or her mother when they are very young, toddlers.
Yes.
So you taught primary children. So what is your first impression about how a child learns? Does a child learn by imitating his elders or peers, or what a child observes the society as at large, or maybe a child at when he's not even old enough to speak, he puts things into his mouth, tries to analyze his or her environment. So what's your impressions? Like what is the first means by which a child is educated or understands his environment?
I'll tell you, the home is the first school.
Okay.
And obviously, the mother will be the first teacher. So, example is better than precept. So, when the child comes to school, the teacher becomes a second mother. Mother or father, because it is a male teacher or the female teacher. And the school becomes a second home. The environment should be conducive to a child. And that's all. And the teaching and learning process becomes very interesting. Personally, to tell you, Julian, I never found it difficult, honestly. I never found it difficult, whether it was those four decades ago or in modern generation, because I understand. Now it is with modern techniques, and they are exposed to a lot of, gadgets, latest gadgets.
The internet.
Yes, internet. And then internet has become 50% disadvantages and 50% advantages. So one has to harness only the good part of that.
Yeah, that's a tool.
It's a tool, what you make of it. Then how much is enough has to be decided by the child. If the child is too small, the parents have to guide. Train the child.
Okay, now I would like to move on to another topic. Now, in training, what is your opinion on discipline and punishment, rewards and encouragement? Like, for example, if how to endorse positive behavior and how to discourage negative behavior on part of a child, how to evolve, how does a child evolve, how to foster his betterment.
You mean training of a child to live into this world?
Yeah, like you started as a primary teacher, so I would want you to elaborate on a small boy or a girl, and even an adolescent or even a high schooler. How do you make sure a child is growing up the right way?
I'll tell you.
More than academics, all-round development, like how Gandhiji said.
Yes. You see, every child is unique.
Yeah, that's true.
Every child is unique. So it is the duty of the teacher to study and keep a record, which I always did. Keep a record of the background of the child, the behavior of the child, and then you will get solutions. Every child has to be handled in a different way. But while teaching, you have to attract the average intelligence, you know, the IQ, I'm saying. Average IQ. And for which you can do justice to the slow learners and the children who can learn very fast. Eventually, everybody learns. And now in India, there is, you know, up to the 8th standard, one has to promote the child. So it is a duty ultimately of parents and the teachers together to bring up the child. It's so, a social responsibility.
Now, what is your thoughts on how a syllabus has to be formed and like the textbooks in general and the ecosystem surrounding the formation of literature and all the study that goes into making content for children to consume while educating them.
Very good. In India, we are in India very good because the population is large. And what the Indian government is doing is excellent. I have nothing to say about it. Okay? And when the child grows up and becomes an adult, he will learn on his own many things. He'll explore.
Yeah, especially today, yes. Nowadays, there's no limit.
Sky's the limit.
There's no limit
to
learning.
He will explore. He or she will explore. So I don't have anything negative about the content that has been introduced in the syllabus. No. It is from simple to complex.
Okay, and do you have any memories, like fond memories in your 43 years of teaching experience, like which you would like to share? Like, for example, a certain experience with maybe a stubborn boy or a clever boy or a hardworking boy or a girl. Because you were in a boys' school, you would have experience with boys. And, would you...
During
like
my
share?
Training, I taught the girls.
Yes.
Yes. And when I finally was appointed, it was the boys' school. And every day was an experience for me. So I have to relive my life to tell you, Julian. Every day was a beautiful day. Every day. That's why I never felt bored. I never. Many people ask me, you're not fed up? You never felt bored? Never. That's why I'm still passionate about going to institutions and giving my best. Because my experience is rich.
Okay. During your training, how is the teacher supposed to use aids in education, like the board, chalk in the board, or a chart, or a projector of late now the modern means, then songs, to teach for young minds, and a poem,
I'll tell you.
Got it. You know what I mean, no?
Yes, it's a mix and match. Sometimes you have to just use the chalk and the board. Sometimes you have to mix audio visual aids. Sometimes chart you can. I had asked my students to paint and draw charts because I knew they were talented, and put it up in the class. So you can, there's no definitive method, you know. You can use the modern, you can also use the old time methods of painting, drawing. And I used to ask my students to do the charts. Very good. And for science, as small as third standard children, we used to do experiments. Not in the laboratory, but little experiments in science that were not dangerous.
Okay.
Like growing a plant.
Okay.
On the ceilings, you know, of the window ceilings, windowsill. Growing the plants, and used to every day water those plants. You know, there was a biology lesson in the third standard. And very interesting. The dicotyledon, the monocotyledon, they planted in the pots and the plant grew. I mean, there's to water. So
yeah,
these are the little beautiful experiences.
Yeah, those memories never fade actually.
And one more example, tell you, there was a boy who was extremely, you know, hyperactive and very intelligent. His IQ was very high. And he used to never pay attention to what I taught because he used to teach the average. He used to keep running around the class. And how to keep him occupied. So I gave him a project and I gave him 8 days. So he used to be busy doing the projects in the class. After 8 days, he used to produce. And I used to be very happy and give him the merit.
Okay.
Understood. So I handled the, you know, hyperactive he was. Very intelligent. So it's like that.
Now, let me just ask you about how do children learn from their peers? Like, for example, maybe, like how, to give you an example, bad words. Mm. Now, parents will never teach children bad words. They have to, they pick up this from the street or from their peers. So, when you come to school, everyone is wearing uniform. So, obviously, people don't dress up differently. In India, that is. So, they will learn some sayings or some bad words or some mannerisms from their peers. Even, in fact, sometimes they're educated by their peers. So, what do you have to say on this?
Bad words means unpleasant words.
Okay, unpleasant words.
Bad words means I really don't know what you mean.
Okay,
unpleasant
words.
Don't tell me their parents will not use. There are parents who use such unpleasant words in the house. So, peers is, you know, teacher has to correct. The parents have to correct and say, sorry, I use that word, but that is not a correct word to be used. So admit if you make a mistake. Parents must admit, because if you do it before children, you have to say sorry if it is wrong. Then they respect you. Understood. And peer pressure, that is actually very, very tough. The parents have to be always vigilant, and so has to the teacher. So there should be communication between parents and teachers. And now it's very easy to communicate because now you have mobiles. Immediately the parents are informed the child has not come to class. Understood.
So,
many years back it was difficult.
So I would like to know the arc of discipline. Like over these 43 years, what was your go-to method to discipline a child? Then
you will
and
be
now.
Surprised, Julian.
Okay.
You will be very surprised.
Yeah.
I never used a ruler and never hit a child. I never ever did it. Never. It was, I really don't know if you ask me, but I used such techniques that made the children happy. I never beat them. Never beat them. I never gave corporal punishment because I don't believe in that.
Okay, now moving forward. Now, this is the age of the internet and technology has advanced a lot.
Yes.
So nowadays we get free lessons online.
Yes.
Most of the many open courseware and open education resources and all. Even the government of India has started digitizing libraries and making them available online, and given aid to teachers so that they can better teach children. So what is your opinion on the new age of education the internet has made possible? So do you think it is a very, very bright future for the young ones who can learn from resources all over the world, the best of the best?
It's very good, Julian, but I'll tell you how naughty some children are. I know of a parent who came and complained and said, my son says his teacher has given him homework and that project is available only online. I want to study. For 1 hour, 2 hours, he was sitting in his study room. Then the mother came and asked him, what are you doing? No, I'm doing the homework. So the parent came to the school and asked, do you give homework that means they get it on the net? No, ma'am said. I wanted a project which is different, which he writes in with his own handwriting and prepares some. So he was sitting and surfing unpleasant things.
Okay.
So it is like that. So, you know, so he has to be made to understand.
So the magic
is innocent.
So the magic is in your, your choice is in your hand.
Yes, ultimately.
Yeah.
Because the student, the child will never understand. You see how it is, you know, Julian, you cannot really explain. There are many circumstances that makes a child do certain things.
So the child has to be guided. Resources to help the parents also understand.
Yes.
And child filters.
Yes.
Online filters.
I don't know how they can do it.
Yeah, softwares are available for that.
Available. Because like in the class...
Parental control softwares are available.
Available. That I don't know.
There is softwares where you can lock the certain websites and all that. Child will not have access to those websites until and unless you enter a password.
But there are some parents who never went to school, you know, illiterate parents.
Yeah.
I feel very sorry for them because they want to educate their children and make them literate, but they don't know. So they come for help to the school.
And
we guide them.
Yeah, and even the mobiles, you know, has to have parental control nowadays.
No, but when you tell the child, no, he will understand. The day you explain and tell him that this is right and this is wrong, he obeys.
These are the formative years.
Yes,
no?
Yes. You have to explain to them, tell them what is right, what is wrong. That is parenting, no? And that is teacher's duty also. So I told you, environment also has to be made conducive for the child to grow. So you cannot blame the child entirely.
Even fake news has to be addressed in the similar manner, no?
Yes.
Because children are exposed to all these nuisance nowadays, nonsense. So
yes.
there has to be a... good, the platforms which have good digital reputation and all have to be encouraged.
Yeah, for this,
yeah.
I usually advise all the institution, introduce one moral science class.
Okay.
I believe in that.
Yeah, and the child has to know right from wrong and how to...
Holistic methods
and how to distinguish between crap and good content.
Yes, right and wrong.
Yeah.
Because something can be right in somebody's eyes and something can be wrong in somebody else's eyes.
So that's also education.
Yes. So
and it is a need of the hour.
That is education, you know. That is education. One has to think. Think and act. Why if you do like this, it happens like this. The negativity, the positivity. Like I always give the example of a knife, Julian. Blade. See, blade is not bad. The knife is not bad. How you use the knife is important. Bring the knife to cut the fruit or use the knife to kill. So the object itself is not bad.
So the computer is like a modern day knife.
Yes. This is very simple way I will explain to the little ones. The grown up ones you can use other examples.
But it is in our time we never had this education online. No, nowadays people can children can just learn from the best of the
of course
best.
That's why some parents, you know, argue and debate that educating children in the house is better than in the school.
Homeschooling.
Because many parents nowadays are thinking. But I don't agree with that for the reason that the social behavior of the child also has to be seen. So when the child comes out, he or she meets with different friends and different and learns to adjust.
Okay.
It's my opinion. Okay. I don't force my opinion on anybody. My opinion is a child has to go to a institution outside the home.
In Australia, they have, I think, homeschooling most because it's wide, very expansive, and they can't transport everyone, I think, to schools. Many children are homeschooled in Australia, if I'm not mistaken.
But I know that students, you know, want to come to school out of the house. And now many parents go to work, father, mother, both. So they prefer their children are safer to be in an institution schooling. Some put their children in the boarding.
And what do you think? Co-ed is better than like solitary?
According to my opinion, co-education
is better.
Is better. And according to me, sometimes it may not work. But
what about uniforms for children?
They should be uniform.
They should be uniform.
Uniformity is a priority in schools. Because everybody, rich, poor, of all, any nationality, any race, they all will look.
And another thing,
uniformity is there.
Another thing I wanted to ask you about midday meals. It's a good scheme, no?
In India, it is a good scheme.
Very good scheme.
Yeah, because there are many children who come from poor backgrounds, financially backward.
And people will, like children will learn to eat with their peers and friends. And it's a very nice experience to dine with your, have lunch or midday meals with your
classmates.
With your friends. Every day is a kind of a
Very important factor is that the food should be clean, you know.
Yeah.
Clean and cooked well. And since it's a mass production, I fear that quality may not be good. It's only that.
Okay.
Understood? It's only that. I think it's enough for today.
Okay.
Thank you, Julian.
Yeah. Thank you, Mom. Yes. Thank you, Mom, for your thoughts. And I would like to tell our listeners that this is the first podcast of my mother, Marilyn Correa, and she would continue posting many more podcasts, and you can subscribe to her podcast feed. We will be
and even my YouTube channel,
and you can comment on her blog and on her YouTube channel. Also, we will be posting this podcast, and please do subscribe and keep updated with her podcast. Thank you for listening, and have a nice day.
Thank you, Julian. Sure.